So hey guys, it's Jonathan Graham here for Guitar Interactive magazine, and we are doing a very special feature right now on the fabulous Martin Guitars, and we're here with Bert Germick from Martin Guitars. Now, where are we here in the factory, Bert?
Well, we're just at the beginning of where we would normally start our public tour. We're right outside the custom shop. And I always like to stop here because there's this wonderful picture of the guy who started it all, Christian Frederick Martin Sr. Started the company back in 1833, and I'm sure he probably didn't have the foresight to see how mature his business would grow in the future, but you know, we have two factories now. This is the one that you're here in, is in Nazareth, Pennsylvania. We have a second factory in Navajo, Mexico, where we produce all of our string product, and our guitar is priced around the $1,000 price point and below. And between the two factories, we probably have roughly between 900 and 1,000 employees, and we're churning out anywhere from 400 to 600 guitars per day, depending on the schedule and where we're at.
Well, that's it. You guys are always constantly very, very busy. Now, just mentioning there, you know, still a family-owned business, so even after all this time, and it's very important to Martin, that, isn't it?
Very important. Christian Frederick Martin IV is the sixth generation to own the company, and he has a daughter, Claire Francis, who may or may not take over the business. So, you know, it's a lot of family, you know, in the upper part of management, but also within the production area, there's a lot of family, a lot of brothers, sisters, aunts, uncles, grandparents. We have a very low turnover rate, so you'll find that family atmosphere within the factory.
Fantastic. So what have we got here behind? Because this is this Andre the Giant's guitar right here?
This is a guitar we started building for Godzilla, but he wouldn't put his deposit down, so we stopped building it. But no, this is a guitar that we used to be featured in the Easton Parade. This part of Pennsylvania is very historic. Easton's a very historic town that's just a few miles from Nazareth. All pre-Revolutionary War towns. And this was actually built by employees back in the 1980s. And it's built to scale. It's a D28. And it got retired. We used to run it in the parade every year, and you know, eventually just found its home here.
And so, it looks like it's the genuine woods as well. There's nothing artificial about it, is there?
It's pretty close to the real deal. You know, I wasn't with the company when we built it, but there's I'm sure there's a lot of similarities in the woods that we use there.
Yeah. Nice one. So let's take a walk through the factory then and see some of the highlights in here.
All right, let's do it.
So basically, just about every hallway has got some kind of historical reference to Martin's past. What is it that we've got right here?
Well, this is an area that we'll usually bring our public tours through and kind of just give them a rundown of the parts and the different materials that we use for the parts. For instance, we have the billets that we use for necks. We primarily use mahogany, but we also use cedar, sipo. We've used sapele in the past. We have some birch laminate material we use for neck stock. I think as you go through the tour today, you're mostly going to see mahogany used for necks. But you can see this is an example of a parallelogram that's cut from lumber. And we'll usually get about six necks. In this case, it's just three because it's a smaller version. But about six necks per parallelogram. And each neck is cut out by hand on a bandsaw. And what you'll see, you'll get a neck billet that kind of looks like that after that first process. And from there, the necks will go on a CNC machine. You'll get to see that a little bit later on. You see what the neck looks like halfway through the CNC machine, and then what it looks like when it comes off. And a lot of people are looking at me when I'll tell them about the CNC, which stands for computer numeric controlled, and we'll see that a little bit later. But there's a really good marriage between modern technology and the hand craftsmanship that we're known for. And what you're going to see as you go through the tour is, even though that these are made on CNC machines, there's an awful lot of handwork that's put into these necks, fingerboards, and other components of the guitar to give them that, give them their specification, and we hold those tight specifications.
Sure.
We also make our fingerboards and our bridges on CNC machines, and typically the fingerboard and bridge will match each other on the instrument. So if it's an ebony fingerboard, it'll get an ebony bridge. If it's a rosewood fingerboard, a rosewood bridge. And you know, usually I'll point out some of the identifying features of a Martin guitar. For instance, this headstock shape here is actually trademarked by Martin. So any other manufacturers using that shape has to have our permission. But another two other identifying features of the Martin guitar is the bridge style. This is an identifying feature of the Martin guitar. This is called the belly style bridge. It's got that shape and the back part of the bridge. The other identifying feature is the pick guard here. If people are looking at a guitar on TV or from a distance, I'll usually suggest looking at the pick guard shape, the bridge shape, and the headstock shape. You can usually tell it's definitely a Martin guitar.
Sure.
The tops of the guitar are probably 80% responsible for the overall sound of the guitar. Mm. And we primarily use Sitka spruce. However, we also use Adirondack spruce. We use mahogany, koa, variety of different materials. We even have a high pressure laminate we use on our X-Series guitars. The majority of what you see today will probably be Sitka spruce. And the spruce comes from Alaska and the northwestern part of the United States, Canada. In that particular area, where Adirondack spruce mostly comes from the east side of Canada and upper Nazareth. And the bracing here is also made out of Sitka spruce. We have some models that we use Adirondack spruce, but a soft wood like spruce is usually the best component for the bracing. We have the various styles, cross braces, tone bars, bridge plates, and just a nice array of different braces that are demonstrated here on this board.
Fantastic.
So here we have just some examples of some of the woods that we use for the back and sides of the guitar. And I mentioned the top is mostly responsible for the sound, but the back and sides are gonna color to some degree. And the two most popular types of wood we use for the back and sides are East Indian rosewood, and then we have mahogany, which is a lighter colored wood. Rosewood is typically a little more warm, a little more bass response to it. People will use the word complex. Mahogany is typically a little bit brighter sounding, a little more sterile, and I have a difficulty telling people one sounds better than the other because it's very subjective. Mm. You know, D18s are made of mahogany, they're great recording guitars, so it's really up to the personal preference. But we also use Hawaiian koa that grows exclusively in the Hawaiian Islands. We have some domestically grown maples that we use. We have a lot of different rosewoods that we began using that are coming from Central America, like Guatemalan rosewood and cocobolo. We have an example here of Brazilian rosewood, and most guitar aficionados recognize Brazilian rosewood's got that wild grain to it, as opposed to East Indian that's more straight grained. And we built all of our guitars out of Brazilian rosewood up until about 1967, and switched over to East Indian rosewood because it was becoming more difficult to get, becoming more expensive. And by 1992, they passed laws that prevented people from cutting Brazilian rosewood trees down now. So, you know, we have less than 1,000 sets of Brazilian rosewood in-house to build custom guitars. And unless you have documentation that indicates that the wood was acquired or cut down prior to 1992, or it fell down naturally in the forest, you can't really purchase it legally.
Sure.
Very difficult.
And for somebody like yourself, who we know you deal very much in terms of buying in the wood for Martin, you've looked at all these woods and heard all the different sounds over the years. Brazilian rosewood, what's your verdict on that in comparison to some of the other woods? Do you think it is a special wood?
Well, I spent about 10 years doing sound testing here at Martin Guitar, and Brazilian rosewood sounds great, but I'll tell you, we still make a lot of East Indian rosewood guitars that are very comparable to Brazilian. And I think that a lot of times people are hearing older guitars and made with Brazilian, and so they instantly think that Brazilian is the best sounding wood out there. But I've done plenty of testing, scientific testing and subjective testing, that indicates that guitars made with East Indian rosewood could be just as good as a Brazilian rosewood guitar.
That's good to know for sure. Okay, so we've got massive rooms for all sorts of different things around here. This is a particularly noisy room. What's going on in here?
So this is our sawmill. This is where we bring in all the raw materials, all the raw lumber, and we process it. In some cases, we get different thicknesses, 12-quarter, 8-quarter, 10-quarter. That's the thickness of the material. And we have some resaws in here that we use for resawing backs and sides. We have two kilns that we just purchased this year. We replaced our old kilns, so we do a bit of drying here. And it's really important to season the wood before you start producing, otherwise the wood's going to start moving around, it'll crack on you. Typically the woods will come in below a moisture content of 20%, in some cases they don't, and we have to lower that moisture content slowly. You don't want to do it too fast. We actually have what we call a wet room, which is kind of like a Florida kind of climate. It's 80 degrees, it's very humid in there, and we'll let it sit in there for a little while. And we have a huge acclimating room that's set to perfect temperature and humidity. We'll put the wood on sticks so the air can breathe, can dry out the lumber or the pieces of wood just using regular air. So we have a couple different processes. The process is totally different depending on the type of wood that we're working with.
Of course, now obviously temperature control is really important all the way throughout with the wood. Even at this stage, does this room need to be a particular temperature?
This room is not controlled like the acclimating room is. So we have spaces within this room that are controlled, like our wet room in the kilns. But this area isn't required to be perfect 50% humidity at 72 degrees.
How many guitars do you think are actually being built currently or are being worked on right now in this room?
Thousands of instruments. We have stacks of wood throughout here that will probably keep us going for the next couple months. We have a couple other warehouses throughout our local area that we're storing wood as well. We typically keep a strategic inventory of some pieces of wood, like mahogany, spruce, rosewood, all the important woods that if we didn't have them would shut production down. So we try to keep several years of strategic inventory in that case. And so that's just a portion of what we have in inventory right now.
Fantastic. We're out of the incredibly noisy room now, but you were talking about in there the kilns that are actually operating within there. How does this thing work then right here?
So this is the brain for the kiln. Mm-hmm. So each type of wood and thickness of wood has its own recipe for drying. So it's all run off of here. Each program will be put in when we put the wood in. There's a dry bulb, a wet bulb, temperature that they have to make sure is at the right temperature for that particular program. And you know, you can see it's telling us what the humidity is of that piece of wood. In this case, it's 36%, so we're going to continue to bring that down. Typically, we want the wood between 8 and 10% before we start building guitars out.
Sure. Now, we've talked a lot about the different woods that are actually used. Does that make a difference here in the temperatures, or is it just kind of standard no matter what temperature you use, which wood you're using?
No, there's a dry bulb and a wet bulb temperature, and those two parameters are very specific to the type of wood that you're drying. So some woods are more oily, so you got to be careful that you're not drying out more oil, which could cause problems later on in the process. So there's a chemical reaction that's going on when they're drying the wood. So.
And off camera as well, we talked a little bit about the lifetime of a guitar. You know, if it's you were saying that basically it could last multiple lifetimes if it's taken care of well. In this process, right at the beginning, is that very important to, well, it must be, I would imagine, to making sure that the guitar has longevity?
Absolutely. This will directly affect the stability of the wood. Mm. So if your wood isn't stable, it's not going to be a good sounding guitar, and it's going to move around. It's not going to stay in tune properly. So this is absolutely critical.
We're in another very special room right here. We know there's some things that we can't get on camera here. There's some top, very, very top secret stuff. But for the stuff that we can look at, I mean, there's just endless amounts of wood here. What have we actually got right here?
Well, this is our acclimating room. So this is what the area that we use for seasoning the wood. And it's always 72 degrees, 50% humidity. And depending on that moisture content of the wood when it comes in, we may have to put the wood on stickers like you see here in the back. Mm. That allows the air to kind of move through the pallet of wood and dry it, you know, on its own. They call it air drying. In some cases, we could just dead pile the wood. You might see that pallet back there. We could just kind of stack it on top of each other. We don't have to air dry it. So it's very dependent on the species of wood and the moisture content that it's at that moment.
Yeah.
And we have tools that we use to measure the moisture content, little probes. You can stick it in, and it's even that probe has a recipe for the species of wood that you're measuring, so you get the proper moisture content.
And how long would something like that sit there for before?
Could be months. Could be a couple of weeks, or could be months.
So. And I guess there's some woods that you've got there that are saved just specifically for very special guitars.
Yeah, we have a special location that we keep all the real fine grades of wood for custom guitars and higher end instruments.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
Well, let's take a closer look at some of these other bits all the way down then. Okay, so we're here with Dan, who is the big man for the custom shop.
You know? Thank
so,
you.
So what have we got over here in this little quiet spot of the Martin factory?
What we have here is torrified Adirondack spruce, mm-hmm. and I'm actually selecting a top for a gentleman in artist relations today.
Mm-hmm. Very nice. Okay, so what's the actual process here then? I mean, how do you, like, you've obviously got these blanks, and then what's the next step?
Yeah, so for me, what I'm doing is I'm going to look at them visually first. I'm going to see if any of them, I think, look incredibly beautiful, mm-hmm. which they're all gorgeous. They're, you know, they're beautiful tops. See if anyone just visually kind of calls out to me, and then I'll take, like, I have three here that I selected, and in the end I've ended up choosing that one.
So for so many people, you know, they would just look at these and they would think, I mean, yeah, they are all going to be high quality because we're at Martin, but it's quite difficult to tell the difference. You're obviously seeing something very, you know, minute differences there. What should people be looking for themselves if they were looking at it?
Well, what I'm looking for in this top end is just I'm trying to find the straightest grain and most uniform piece that I can. With the Adirondack spruce, sometimes it's very difficult because the trees are smaller, so the growth rings, they're varied. Mm. So I'm just trying to find the nicest piece that I can find in the grade that I'm allowed to pick from.
Okay, and would you say this is actually something that, I mean, I've got my opinions on it, but I want to know yours. Makes a sonic difference, or is this pure aesthetics?
I think it's a little bit of both. Mm. I think aesthetically it does give you a nice look of an older top. Sonically, when I heard these torrified tops, I became a believer. Mm. There's a certain mature sound that comes out of them that if you're looking for something that is accelerated, something of a top that's maybe 10 or 15, maybe 20 years down the line of being played in, and the torrified is a great way to go. It kind of gives you a great step in that direction.
So this table right here where we've got these John Mayer's guitars, the list goes on,
yes.
They'll all at some point have been, the top will have been sitting
there.
It will
have all touched this table right here. You're correct about that.
Okay, so Jimmy, what have we got right here? Because this is some alien-looking wood right here, but it is just rosewood, isn't it? But it's amazing.
Yeah, this is East Indian rosewood, but instead of it being quarter sawn, so you get the super straight grain, it's flat sawn. And of course there must have been something going on with the growth of the wood to get this extreme of a pattern. Because we typically don't see this. When we flat saw stuff, you'll typically see grain that kind of goes off kilter and it's a little figured. But I mean, this is something that looks, you know, I mean, basically alien, like you said.
Yeah.
Just a beautiful set. These are pretty special, so we'll actually we'll spec this for an in-house custom.
Okay.
And it'll be something over the top. And then when dealers and distributors come in from all over the world, we'll display this for them, and they'll have the opportunity to bid on it.
Sure.
And hopefully we'll make a sale.
And then they'll say, "I want another 300, please." And then where are you going to find those?
I don't think we'll find 300 of these. This might be the only few sets that we have of something that looks this beautiful.
Now, this is something particularly unique to Martin, isn't it? The fact that you can get access to very special woods like this. Well, you know, why is it that you're able to do a lot what the other acoustic brands aren't and get stuff like this?
I think it's just attributed to the relationships that we have across the world with different vendors for woods and stuff like that. And our wood specialists, you know, they get basically first dibs on this stuff.
Yeah.
You know, they'll come to us first and say, "Hey, we have something really special that we think you might like." And then our guys go and look at it and we'll bring it in-house.
So at this stage, you know, sitting on the table right now, how long before that becomes a fully fledged guitar?
Well, we like to put some conscious effort into, you know, a unique design. You know, it might get some crazy pearl, you know. So from the time that we set up the spec for it, you're probably going to see a lead time of somewhere to 6 to 8 months.
Right.
If we go something a little less pearl, it might be 4 to 6 months.
Okay, and the wood itself, I mean, it almost looks like it's ready just to go into a guitar as it is. Do you need to do much to it after it's cut and then, you know, pieced together?
Yeah, I mean, this isn't, it's not sanded to final thickness yet, so it'll go through that process down here in the machine room. And then it'll make its way upstairs, and then even from there, it still gets a lot of hand attention, which I'm sure you're going to see on your tour as you walk through the factory.
Mm. Fantastic. Well, thanks for showing us. These look amazing.
Yeah, sure thing.
So we've just seen there all the selections that can be had with the different tops and so much options. At this stage, it needs to be put together, doesn't it? It needs to be matched. Is this what these guys are doing right now?
Yeah, so this is where we match the East Indian rosewood backs and sides. And what we were looking at before was more of a custom chop process. This is us producing, mass producing rosewood guitars. And the backs and sides don't always come from the same tree.
Right.
In some cases they do, in some cases they don't. So in the cases where they don't, this is how we go about making sure that the grain orientation and the color all match, and it has that continuity. So it's a pretty tedious process. You got to basically take a set of backs and walk around until you find something that looks very, very close to to coming from the same tree.
Do you find, just what you're saying there, that it can, you know, you try and find one that seems like it could come from the same tree, but some obviously don't. Do you think sonically it makes a difference when it's all that same tree that created the guitar, or would that just be?
It would be very difficult to measure that.
Yeah.
I personally don't think that it's going to have that much of an impact, because like I said, the top mostly generates the sound. These are kind of a reflection surface, so I don't think it's going to have as much of an impact.
Mm, interesting, okay, yeah. And as well, I suppose, is there ever any occasions with this where you'll actually create a guitar where it's maybe not that well matched, just to see visually how it would look? I mean, obviously we're seeing here that these two are very different, but it might make a quite an interesting looking guitar.
Well, there are some instruments that are kind of part of the lower end of the line that we can use mismatched rosewood, but through the finishing process, you won't be able to tell, because there's some coloring that occurs during the finishing process.
Sure.
So, you know, the majority of our guitars have matched backs and sides.
Okay, yeah.
And, you know, that comes down to the sustainability of the material and the best use of the material. And there's been situations in my career where we had 2,000 sets of sides that didn't match anything. And it's perfectly good wood.
Yeah.
So what are you going to do with that? So you develop a model that's at the right price point where you could do something like that. And then you try to work something into the process so that it's not as visible.
Well, that's interesting. So the actual the wood itself can dictate a brand new model.
It could.
Yeah.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Oh wow. Okay.
Yeah.
Interesting.
So this is where we glue the matched sets of rosewood together. The sets come in book matched. Basically, the wood is quarter sawn, and it's sliced into thin veneers, and you take two of those, you fold them open, and the grain is symmetrical, if they mean by book matching. So each one of these book matched backs will be glued up on this machine here. It's a hydraulic press with two different clamping systems on it, and what they'll do is they'll run the edge, they'll join the edges first, make sure that they're perfectly tight. And then there's a purfling strip that they glue in between the two book match pieces. So they'll simply just run that over a glue wheel and put it in place after putting in the purfling. They'll put that into the press and they'll put that purfling in between. And then there's two sets of clamps. And it'll be in that press for a minimum of an hour, but basically he's just gonna keep working his way around. And it roughly takes about an hour to go through the whole thing. So when I started here 25 years ago, this is one of the first jobs I had to do, only the machine I was using at the time was the oldest piece of equipment in the plant. And we didn't have these fancy hydraulic clamping systems, you had to do it by hand. And at the end of the day, your hands would just kind of throb.
I bet. We're looking at tops and sides now. These are actually for the fingerboards, isn't it? So what's going on here?
So this is a CNC machine, and it's fabricating Cataloche fingerboards at the moment. And there's actually three operations that occurs on this machine. The first process right now, it's putting in location holes, so it allows us to locate that fingerboard on different fixtures and on the neck itself throughout the assembly process. Then there's another separate process that's on there where they actually put a radius on the fingerboard. And then the last, when it goes on top of the fixture, the last process is to put the fret slots in it. This is a really good example of some of the more modern technology that we're using to produce guitars. And these machines can fabricate parts to 2/1000ths of an inch.
Wow.
So it's very precise. There's handwork done to the bridges as well, so it's an example of the hand craftsmanship that we do in addition to using the new technology.
Yeah, you really do notice that everywhere you look around the factory, people have these in their hands, you know, with different parts. There's nothing that seems to be, it's got to be cut with a machine and stuff to make sure that it's very accurate, but a lot of hand finishing going on, isn't there?
Yeah, absolutely.
And you've done many different tasks in this building as well, so list them off. What's been your journey through Martin?
I've spent a lot of time in machining parts on CNC machines, building parts. I spent quite a bit of time in customer service and repairs, years in quality assurance, making sure that the quality levels are where they should be. I spent 13 years in research and development, developing string products, working with our electronic suppliers, and developing products. Yeah. And most recently, I've been procuring wood for the company. So yeah, that's been my latest job.
25 years, eh? So you started as a teenager?
Yeah.
Very good. Friend.
I was 12. Right now, I'd be fabricating necks on a CNC machine. And these are our dovetail, which is a standard neck-to-body joint. These are dovetail necks as opposed to a simple dovetail neck joint. And he's just doing some finishing for the process itself. These necks came off the machine, and he's just cleaning them up for the next process, really. In every case, we'll put a little brass insert in the hole that you see there on the necks. That's there so that they can put the neck on different fixturing as it goes through the process. Dovetails don't get bolted in. Simple dovetails do get a bolt. They also get glued in. Dovetails are just are glued in. So whenever I give tours, people are always like, well, what's the bolt for? It's really just for locating. We have two Heian brand CNC machines that are responsible for cutting our necks. We can do roughly about 24 necks in a half hour time period. And right now they're cutting mahogany necks. And this is actually the second cut. There's a process before this CNC process where they create a channel for the truss rod. They cut the headstock to thickness, and they surface the area where the fingerboard will be glued to. Once that process is done, this is where it comes over, and they actually profile the barrel, cut the dovetail, neck to body joint, and carve out the heel of the neck.
So obviously we've seen there around the factory, thousands of guitars are getting made all the time, but things being wasted or, you know, sustainability is super important to Martin, isn't it? So what do you guys do to sort of combat that?
Well, sustainability is definitely at the core of our internal competency. You know, we have meetings to discuss materials, even down to the types of cups we use for coffee. But the wood sustainability is an extremely important piece to us. We try to source woods from areas that are managed and they're not clear cutting, extremely important. And there's a certifying body, international certifying body called FSC, Forest Stewardship Council. And we try to source materials that have that FSC label. And FSC has a rigorous approach to making sure that companies are not illegally harvesting their woods, and they're managing not just the forest itself, but the people around it as well. And so that's extremely important to us. Our mahogany is all FSC 100%. Our cedar is 100% FSC. Sapele, ebony, all these woods are 100% FSC. And when we can't get 100 FSC, we'll be happy with just getting an FSC mixed credit or a controlled wood. So for instance, our East Indian rosewood is FSC controlled wood. That means it's going through the hands of suppliers that know the concepts of FSC and kind of work with those sort of constraints and concepts.
Do you feel quite positive about where things are going in terms of the wood supplies and what have you? Because obviously for a while there, CITES was a big problem. Certainly in the UK, we were having a hard time getting our hands on a lot of these instruments with the woods that were, required. Do you feel positive about the future?
Well, I think more and more music instrument companies are going to have to pay attention to the regulation that is around a lot of these exotic woods that we're using. I don't think we'll ever feel comfortable, for the future, because we have to make sure that people outside of our control are doing the right things. And I think there's a lot of great things going on out there. Martin is kind of we're really trying to get involved with the CITES regulations, FSC, and really trying to do the right thing sourcing. And I think if enough of us come together and have a voice about this, we can make some change.
Yeah.
And I think the more people know about it, the more people will kind of want that, In the music industry, I don't think everyone has really caught on to the importance of FSC. We do have a few instruments that are 100% FSC certified. I think that we could do better in general with getting the public to accept this material and want this material.
Sure, that's good to know. So 9 times out of 10, if you've bought an acoustic guitar over the last 25 years, there's probably a good chance it's got some Martin strings on there from the store.
Yeah, that's right. Strings are a big part of our business. We produce about 6 million sets of strings a year. And all of our string manufacturing is in Mexico. We have a couple machines here to kind of demonstrate how the strings are made. But our focus is on acoustic strings, but we do make Darko electric strings.
Sure.
We make mandolin strings, banjo strings, classical guitar strings, ukulele strings. So we're not just pigeonholed into just making acoustic strings, but that would probably be the biggest part of that business.
Sure. And the last, I think it's maybe just the last year, you had quite a bit of a change in terms of what strings are available now. Because in the past there was many, many different options, but you've kind of narrowed it down a little bit more in the last year, haven't you? So what are those string options that people can get now?
Well, now we have the authentic acoustic line of strings, and they all have a higher tensile core wire, tin-plated core wire, similar to our SPs. You can get those in your standard sets of strings. You can get them with a silk wrapping at the end, which protects your bridge plate. It's good for older instruments. It kind of takes over the marquee line that we had. And then we have our Lifespan 2.0,
sure,
which is a treated string, probably the best treated string out in the market. They really last, and I highly recommend checking those out. So this is an extremely important part of the process. This is where we do the grading for the tops. And depending on the price point of your guitar, you're gonna have a different grade top. Every top that Dee inspects here starts out as a grade 8. Grade 8 is our highest quality top. It's what you'd find on a D45. And it's gonna have perfectly quartered straight grain with no blemishes, perfect top. Every top that she inspects starts out as a grade 8, and she deducts points based on some of the characteristics she might see.
Ah, okay.
There could be a little bit, it could be a little off quarter, so there's a specification for that, but it can't be too much off quarter, otherwise that top is not gonna be stiff enough to withstand the string tension. She's gonna look for knots, sap pockets, wind breaks, bear claw, which is just a figure in the wood that some people like and some people don't. There's point deductions based on some of these characteristics, and sometimes they'll fall underneath the pattern. So we have a, this is in this case, it's an aught size pattern. The defect might fall below the pick guard or get cut out around the sound hole. And so these are the sort of things that we're trying to use. We're trying to utilize this wood to the best of our ability.
Yeah.
So she'll keep deducting points until it finally doesn't meet our specification for any instrument, which would be a grade 0.
Yeah.
And in that case, it would be kicked out. But this is critical for the sound of the guitar and the aesthetics of the guitar.
Of course, no, make sure.
She's running a light through it, and we call that candling. And that enables us to see any defects that might be in the wood that haven't surfaced yet. So, because the last thing we want to be doing is making a D45 with a grade 8 top. We're doing our sanding preparations for finishing,
yeah,
and all of a sudden a knot surfaces, and then we have to cut the top off, which, you know, it happens, you know.
Does
so
it really?
We're trying to really eliminate those sort of defects throughout production. Right now we're at the rosetting stage, and the rosette is another name for the decoration that goes around the sound hole. The rosette is made up of several fibers of either a wood fiber or Boltron plastic, and they glue all those fibers in at one time. It's important for them to measure the thickness of these fibers because they can fluctuate in thickness, so they want to make sure they test the lot of material they're going to inlay before they create the channel. We have a separate machine that creates the channel for us, and then we use a Duco cement to glue all those layers in all at one time. And don't let her fool you. It makes it look a lot easier than it is. After she gets done doing this process, the tops will sit for about 24 hours so that glue cures, and then it'll get one more sanding process so we sand it down to the final thickness, and then we're ready to start putting braces on it. These are laser cutters that we use for profiling the top, back, and sides from a blank piece of wood into what looks like a top, back, or side. And we use this laser technology because it really helps us to reduce any rejects we might have specifically because of the process itself. Years ago, we'd use rotary cutters, and when you're cutting wild grain wood like Brazilian rosewood, sometimes the blade can kind of catch a grain, rip it out, and then you have a part that you can't use because of your process, not necessarily because it's a bad piece of wood. With these laser cutters, that totally eliminates that sort of thing from happening. So I've been using these for a number of years. They're very consistent, and they do a great job.
So we've just gone through there and seen some of the most high-tech equipment probably used in any guitar factory. What's going on right here? We've got some clothes pegs holding this one together.
Yeah, this is a process that really hasn't changed much since clothespins were invented. This is where we install the ribbon lining, but this is part of our custom shop. And we were talking a little bit about the authentic series guitars and going back and building guitars the way we would have built them back in the 1930s. Right here, he's actually gluing in the ribbon lining using hide glue. So that's why he's got these heat lamps on the rim. And there's a small vat of glue that's heated as well. Very tricky when working with the hide glue because it sets up fairly quickly. So you gotta work quickly. It does have its sonic advantages. It's a little more crystalline, so the vibration transmits a little bit better throughout the instrument, which is why we kind of reverted back to it for these instruments. You can see, we really try to make the inside of the guitar look as good as the outside.
Sure.
So we painstakingly go through, remove any squeeze out that might be there from the glue, and just want to make sure everything's perfect. Another thing about this rim that he's working on, you can see these strips that are within the inside of the rim there. Those are made of cloth. That was a traditional material that would have been used back in the 1930s. And it's there to reinforce the sides. The sides are the most fragile part of the guitar. And depending on your species of wood and the actual shape of it, you may have to use more or less structure there to keep it stable.
So for those guys, you know, back in the day, putting these together and using, you know, a very similar process to this, certainly the same materials, how do you think they managed to figure it all out so quickly back then? And then, you know, to the point that these days, you know, we're using different materials, but you still kind of feel like this is the best process.
Well, I'm sure it was a lot of trial and error over the years, you know, and the Martin family's been building guitars for over 183 years. So
yeah.
I think just through trial and error, just testing stuff, and we never rested our laurels. We continue to experiment and find the best process even to today.
Fantastic.
Right now we're putting the bracing on the top of the guitar, and what she's doing is running each piece over a glue wheel, putting it in the location that's marked. We have a marking operation that we do before the tops come over, and these tops are heated to 110 degrees, so that allows us to cure the glue in a little bit faster without compromising the actual glue bond. And after she gets done gluing these all in place, she'll close the lid and hit a button, and there's a vacuum that draws out all the air, and a rubber bladder comes down and applies an even distribution of pressure over the entire top. Tops need to be in there for roughly about 6 to 10 minutes, and then it can be removed. And after this process, it'll go on to the actual shaping of the bracing, which is done by hand. One thing to note about that top is it had the X bracing pattern. And the X bracing pattern is one of the big innovations that the Martin family had on the acoustic guitar, the American acoustic guitar. Prior to the X bracing pattern, you know, the guitars had a fan bracing or a Spanish style bracing pattern. And up until recent years, we always thought that X bracing was developed in the 1850s.
Yeah.
Just a few years ago, we found a guitar that was built in 1843, that had that X bracing pattern.
Wow.
So it was very early on in C.F. Martin Sr.'s career that he developed that. And the majority of acoustic guitars that are out there, whether it's a Martin or another brand, have that X bracing pattern. And the reason for it is because of the stability that it gives the top and the sound quality.
Sure.
And depending on whether you scalp the bracing or leave the bracing a little bit thicker, these are all ways that you can voice the instrument and change the characteristics of the tone.
Of course.
This is the D200, and the D200 is modeled after the 2 millionth guitar. It has a watch theme. There's a watch that comes with the instrument that matches the theme of the guitar. And this is probably our most expensive standard instrument that we produce. And it's got a lot of exotic woods to it, a lot of exotic inlay material as well. And it takes several months to put these together. Just to show you the level of detail and craftsmanship that goes into that guitar.
Now, how long would something like this take to put together in comparison to just your regular guitar?
Well, we only build them when we get orders for them. And it'll take 4 to 6 months to get this through the line. You know, we have to inlay all those parts before we can start assembling the instrument. So it's a very time-consuming instrument to produce.
Now, you say when you get orders for them, would it be possible for someone to actually just get in contact with Martin and say, hey, I want X done and you guys can do it? Or do you always need to go through a store?
Yeah, we have a distribution network that we send our customers to. We have a dealer network domestically or here in the United States, and then throughout the world we have distribution agreements with companies. So in London you'd have to contact the distributor of Martin.
It's just I know you know, the phones will be ringing off the hook for these because there's be so many people that can afford them, so they got to know where to get them, you know.
That's right. It's probably not an instrument you're going to find in stock at a dealership. Yeah. But we've sold about 18 of them so far.
Okay.
So
yeah, beautiful instrument.
We'd call it a success. So since trees don't grow in the shape of guitars, you got to shape the wood into the guitar shape, right? So this is where we do our side bending. This is done using heat and moisture. We typically have side forms for each type of body shape. The process is always different depending on the species of wood you're working with. In some cases, you can just spray the wood, apply the moisture that way,
yeah,
put it in the press. In some cases, if the wood's got a wilder grain pattern, you got to soak it in a water glycerin solution for a period of time before you can put it in the press.
I see.
The presses are heated to about 380 degrees, and typically we'll use the presses that have a shape to them already, and we can bend a set in roughly about 10 minutes. After we glue the sides up, we don't want them to sit around for too long and relax and go back to their original shape. So we glue them into the front and rear blocks fairly quickly, and the front and rear block is kind of the main structural support to the guitar. It's where the back, the sides, the top, the neck are all glued into. And we have a special fixture he uses to glue those components in. We use just a type bond woodworking glue to glue it in. After he gets done gluing the components onto the sides, we call that the rim. The rim will sit on the shelf here in C clamps for about an hour before it can move on to the next process.
Okay, so what have you got here in your hands?
So these are laser cutter machines here that we use for branding the instrument. So if you're looking at a guitar and you want to make sure it's a real Martin guitar, you look inside the sound hole up towards the neck area and you'll see this front block. And the front block is always marked with the Martin logo, the style of the guitar, and the serial number of the guitar. And the older guitars don't have the Martin logo. Probably within the last 20, 25 years, we started adding the logo. With the serial number of the guitar, that's how you can date the instrument. We record the last serial number every year at the end of the year. And we have a chart. And if you wanted to find out what year your guitar was built, you look at the serial number chart and find out where your serial number would fall. The chart only goes back to 1898, though. Prior to 1898, we didn't have serial numbers on the guitar.
I've got a few in there that I'm not going to be able to date. Oh.
So this is where we glue the top and back onto the sides of the guitar. as I mentioned, we call the rim up to this point. We put the rim into an aluminum casting form, and we're going to sand that ribbon so it's nice and flush, so we have a nice even surface for the top and back onto the sides. We do the top and back at the same time, but before we do that, we have a clear plastic template we put over the rim, and we notch out the ribbon lining anywhere where the bracing is going to be tucked into a pocket. When you look inside a Martin guitar, the bracing doesn't butt up against the ribbon. It gets tucked into this pocket. So they create all those pockets. They'll run a bead of type on woodworking glue around the rim, glue the top on, flip it over, repeat the process for the back, and then they'll put it into this press here for about 25 minutes, which is, press is also heated to about 110 degrees to help with that curing process. Sure. So after the top and back are glued onto the rim of the guitar, we trim off all the excess material. We start preparing the body for binding. And binding is the material that goes around the body. It's there for structural support. It also adds to the cosmetics of the instrument. Just like the rosette material, they want to measure the binding, which is usually a plastic Voltron or a wood fiber. They want to create their channel based on that material. We call this the phrasing process, and it basically just creates a channel that goes around the instrument and has a place for that binding to be glued to. So here we're gluing the ribbon into place, and we'll use, again, a Duco cement or like a model airplane glue to glue that in place. And as we work our way around the instrument, they simply use masking tape to hold it in place. It'll be in that masking tape for at least 24 hours, gives that glue enough time to cure before it moves on to the next process, which is actually like a sanding process. So you want to make sure that the sanding doesn't heat up your glue and, you know, have it come apart.
So heading away in the corner here at the Martin factory, what's happening here?
So this is, another really critical step for the building process. This is where they fit the neck to the body. This is done by hand. This is a dovetail neck to body joint that he's working on right now. And definitely don't recommend ever hitting your guitar with a hammer unless you've been trained by this guy. But anyway, he's gonna, right now he's just fitting the heel cap onto the guitar, but before he did all this, he was cutting multiple angles. You can see on the shelf here what the dovetail looks like, and there's about three different angles that he has to cut, and he's adjusting the neck both forward and backward and side to side. Very critical for the playability of the guitar. If the neck is set too far forward, the strings are going to be very far off the fretboard. If the neck is set back too far, the strings will be too close to the fretboard, so very critical to the playability and the transmission of the sound between the neck and the body. If you don't have a good neck fit, you're probably not going to have a good sounding guitar. So after the neck fitting process with the dovetails, the neck is going to go in one direction, the body is going to go in another direction, and they're going to meet up after you put the lacquer on the guitar. So he's going to mark the specific serial number of that guitar on the neck and on the body, and they have to meet up for the final fit. If we're building a guitar that has a simple dovetail, the process is much different. We run our guitars through in batches of seven. Any one of those seven necks can fit into any one of those seven bodies, so there's no pre-fit operation that's required. So it helps us to lower the overall cost of the instrument. So this is the fretting department. We use a nickel alloy for the frets. And what they'll do is they'll run a small bead of glue in each fret slot, lay out all the frets on the fretboard, just tap them into place, and then they use this machine here to compression fit all the frets at one time. After the fingerboard is fretted, it goes to the back end of the department where there's some fixtures that they use for gluing the fingerboard onto the neck. When they glue that fingerboard onto the neck, they install an adjustable truss rod. And the adjustable truss rod gives the end user the ability to make neck adjustments with temperature and humidity changes throughout the years. After the fingerboard is glued onto the neck, we're going to want to start shaping the neck so you don't feel a transition between the fingerboard and the rest of the neck, what they call the barrel of the neck. But those fret ends are going to be sharp, so we need to shape those as well, make sure it's a nice smooth feel when you're playing the guitar.
So we're getting into the kind of finishing stages of these guitars now. What's happening here?
So this is the pre-finish body sanding operation. Each body will be sanded with about four different grits of sandpaper. You can see that the bodies are attached to a vacuum stand. The vacuum stand enables them to move that body around, get into the harder reach place. It makes the job a little bit easier. And these booths are set up so it eliminates the dust right away and replenishes with fresh air. So they don't necessarily have to wear a respirator unless they have an allergy to dust. But sure. They're gonna, basically this is all in preparation of putting lacquer on the instrument. Okay.
So we're just taking a look at the body there. Same sort of thing needs to apply to the neck, but in much more detail, is that right?
Much more detail. I mentioned we use CNC technology for making the necks, but this is where all the hand craftsmanship goes into it. You can see right now he's shaping that volute, that diamond shape I was talking about. But we have a lot of different neck shapes, and we have C shapes. We have low profile, low oval, full thickness, different widths of the neck. So. They want to make sure that each neck is consistent. If you're in a music store and there's 5D28s on the wall, they should all feel about the same. So this is where we make sure we have that consistency. They have special calls that they use to make sure they're taking just the right amount of material off. And when your thumb is against the back of the barrel of the neck, it feels the way it should feel, the way a Martin should feel. So this is another example of some of the hand craftsmanship that goes into the instrument. When we're preparing the bodies for finishing, we'll apply a filler to the wood, which kind of fills in the porousness, helps us to get that glass-like look. And when we apply the filler, which kind of looks like a thick brown paint that you buff into the wood, it winds up covering the bindings and some of the areas you don't want stained brown. So we go back with a razor blade by hand and remove all that filler so we bring out the proper color in the bindings in some of these other areas.
Okay, so another important part of the process, I suppose, is got to make sure that there's no problems towards the end of the guitar leaving the factory. So what's happening here?
Well, the finishing is definitely the most sensitive part of production. And so he's just looking for any sort of defects, any sort of high spots or areas of the finish that aren't going to conform to our specification.
So is there things that would typically appear here, or could it be any type of issue?
Probably any type of issue here. I mean, he's mostly looking at the finish, but if there's something that may have been passed from another department, this is another inspection area to catch those sort of thing. When it comes to quality, each employee is responsible for their own quality. Mm-hmm. And we have quality assurance people that kind of come around and make sure that they have the right tools to ensure they can produce the right quality. They have the right specifications and they have the right tools to do that.
Not only acoustic guitars, but also ukuleles in the Martin factory, is that right?
Absolutely. We are really known for making ukuleles. Back in the 1920s, we made more ukuleles than we did guitars. And we kind of moved away from the ukulele. In the early 90s, we weren't making any ukuleles. And then in the early 2000s, the ukulele came back and we started getting demand for them. And right now, Clark's doing some finish work here on a looks like a tenor size ukulele, but we produce soprano size, concert, and tenor. The one he's working on right now is some beautiful koa wood.
So now we come to the finished sanding booths, and quite a lot of activity going on here. You want to talk us through it?
Yeah, this is our finished sanding area, and we have a couple different types of finish that we use. The traditional finish is nitrocellulose lacquer. And nitrocellulose lacquer requires about 6 coats, and in between each coat of lacquer, we do a sanding process. And it's very similar to what we saw earlier, except we're using finer grit sandpaper. And so by sanding and building, it's going to get that nice glass-like look. So if you were to look closely at some of these bodies that are hanging, they still kind of look porous because they don't have all their coats on it. This is our lacquer curing room, and each neck and body will go into this room for anywhere from 24 hours to 36 hours of the shot in between each coat of finish. And the climate is a bit more humid and warmer than you would expect it to be, but it's a certain climate that's required for that finish to cure properly. So this is all part of our finishing operation. So I just want to point this out. This demonstrates the level of detail we go into building our guitars. He's measuring the thickness of the finish throughout the instrument. And the thickness is critical for the sound quality of the guitar. So we're trying to make sure we get a certain consistency there. He has a specification that he's looking at to make sure that the finish is the proper thickness.
Sure. Now we're getting into some serious robot action right here.
Yeah, this is a good example of the robotics we use in our manufacturing. And this one's responsible for the first buffing process. After we have all the coats, the finish on, everything's cured, this robot knows just how much pressure to apply to these buffing wheels that have a polishing compound on them. And it knows just how much pressure to put on so it doesn't burn through the finish. So this is one of those technologies that really helps us to reduce repairs because of the process itself. This could be a finicky process if you're doing it by hand and you don't know how thick your finish is. You can really wind up burning through. And when you burn through the finish, the only way to repair it is stripping it and starting all over. And that's something we definitely want to avoid when we're manufacturing. So we've been using these robots for probably 20 years or more now, and they've worked out very well.
And I guess with something like this, it's got to be built exactly to spec for this process. I mean,
yeah, this was custom built. Yeah. A lot of the machines that you see throughout our factory were either built in-house by a group of engineers that we have in-house, or we have outside people that will develop their off-the-shelf products for us specifically. Yeah. So this is a case where this was made specifically for guitars.
Is there going to be any more developments like that in the future? Do you see more robots being implemented within the factory?
Yeah, we continue to implement robotics in our facility down in Mexico. We're starting to use a little bit more robotics down there as well. So we'll use it where we feel like we can get an advantage by using it, not just because we think we should.
Yeah.
This
guy's fascinating. You could watch him all day.
Yeah.
So as we were saying there about the robots and implementation of robots throughout the factory, it's a big, big part of the process now, but there's a part back here that we can't quite get in to see. It's a little too dangerous in there, but do you want to talk us through what's going on in there?
Yeah, that's our finishing process, and again, we use robotics for finishing, but we have to be careful with electronics in that area so that we don't cause any minor problems. We have these pictures we're going to go over and talk about with you. So. There's three robots that are responsible for spraying a particular component. We'll just talk about the bodies in this case. The bodies run through an assembly line, and each body will stop at the first robot, gets sprayed, moves to the next robot, turns, gets sprayed, and moves on to the next robot, turns again, and sprays the remainder of the body. And then at the very end, we'll hit it with some heat just to get that curing process started. And then it'll go back to that curing room that we talked about. Then it'll get sanded. They'll come back for another coat. And so it does that process 4 to 6 times depending on the finishing package. This is definitely the most time-consuming part for building the guitar, and also the most sensitive part.
So obviously a big part of Martin's history is its relationship with its artists. Why is it such a special relationship, and what is it that you guys do with artists that is particularly unique to Martin?
Well, I think that in a lot of cases, being an ambassador for our brand, it kind of elevates the artist in some ways. In the past, we've kind of worked artist relations in that we honor artists with a signature Martin guitar, such as the Gene Autry, who kind of brought the D45 to market back in the day. It is very important for us to relate to our current end users, and we have a lot of ambassadors that are newer and coming out, and so I think we have that same effect with the newer artists that are ambassadors for our brand, in that they we're kind of honoring them and they're honoring us as well. So there's a mutual benefit for Martin Guitar, and also those prestigious players that are up and coming or have been out there for a number of years.
So we've got some more very intricate work going on here, but this is actually using the pearl inserts, isn't it? So talk us through this.
Yeah, so this is where we do all of the pearl inlay, and we install the pearl inlay right before the finishing process. Very tedious process. They want to make sure that they're getting good bonds between each piece of pearl. Each piece of pearl is very small, so they a lot of times just using magnifying glasses to see exactly what they're doing. In some areas, they have to do a miter joint. Sometimes they'll do butt joints, but it's critical that all these pieces of pearl are super tight. If they're not tight when they put the finish on, finish will kind of fall in between those cracks and it'll look terrible. So this is definitely one of the higher skilled jobs.
Sure.
And you know, it looks like he's working on a higher end instrument. It's like a D45 would get pearl around every border, including around the neck area. In this case, it looks like he's just inlaying some of the white-black pieces that borders that go around the pearl.
Okay, yeah.
So this is an example of a pearl shell when it's harvested from the South Pacific Ocean. And what's interesting about this material is when they dive for the animal, it's not the pearl shell that they want, it's the meat inside. Hmm. This is actually a byproduct, which you use for jewelry, or in our case, inlaying guitars. But some of the higher end instruments, we might use solid pearl shell.
Mm-hmm.
In most cases, we use a material called abalam, which is actually a laminated material. And it's the best utilization of the shell and also gives you the best appearance of the shell. So that material might be several layers and it'll be cut into small pieces like this. And the top layer will have the most colorful piece. Mm-hmm. And you know, we have a green and a pink hue. You can specify that if you're ordering a custom instrument, if there's something specific you want. Mm-hmm. But as the guitar goes through all these different processes on a guitar, this is like an exploded version of a D45. You can see these pieces of plastic that we put into the channel. So when they're putting binding around the instrument or putting the rosette in, mm-hmm. they'll put a piece of this plastic as a placeholder, and then they pull it out. They have a nice channel that they can begin inlaying the pearl.
Okay, yeah.
So hey guys, we're now at a very important process in the lifetime of, or the very early life of the guitar, but the final inspection. Mike's going to talk us through how this process happens at Martin Guitar. So what's happening right here?
So I believe Bert took you up to the pluck machines. Then the first thing is the guitars get strung. He's cutting the ends off. He'll then tune it, play it a little bit, then do some visual inspections of one end to the other to make sure everything is within our quality control. This is installing a pick guard. Has to be in the exact right place.
Makes it look easy, but easy to get wrong.
Yes. He'll check to make sure there's enough distance between the frets and the strings, make sure everything plays in tune, it doesn't go out of tune as you go down the fingerboard. Make sure that the note between is plus or minus 5 cents, one note to the next note. Stretching the strings a little bit, make sure that they can tune up the pitch.
What would you reckon is the, you know, percentage where there would maybe be something wrong at this stage?
We do so many quality inspections along the way that by the time it hits this, it's rare. It's maybe 1 out of 1,000 at that.
Ready to go on someone's album?
Yeah, so from here now it'll go in the case, and then we have a distribution center about 5 miles away. That's where we fill up all the big boxes. Okay. Full of the guitars and ship them all over the world.
We've come away from the main Martin factory and we've headed to North Street where the old factory used to be, and we're going to head inside because it's raining out here. Now, you've taken us to a very special location here. This is totally off the regular track for the Martin Tours, isn't it?
Yeah, this is something we don't show anybody. This is the third story of the old factory. Mm. This is the attic built early 1900s. And it's just where we store some of our very bigger, larger workbenches from past Martins and past Martin employees and machinery that's gone, you know, no longer functional thanks to technology or just overuse. And what we're trying to do is build like a little window into the past where people can see through the decades how the building of stringed instruments has changed at Martin Guitar.
So will this become part of a tour at some point as well, do you think?
We hope so.
Yeah.
Yeah. Maybe not a general everyday tour, but maybe like for special occasions, dinner meetings and stuff like that. We'll make it like a little.
Sure. Well, it's obviously a very special historic location because up until, 65, something like that?
64.
64, everything would have come out of here, yeah?
Everything was built in this part of the factory. Then they came back from a music show and said, well, if we don't expand, we can work for 3 years without any more guitars. And that's when they broke ground on the new facility.
Okay.
That's not actually C.F. Martin's desk, but it's a copy of the desk C.F. Martin the first brought with him from Mark McCurchin.
Okay.
And then you can see we put some letters, copies of some letters. We jump a little bit and we have a guitar case that was very prominent. 1890s, it was like a canvassy leather strapped down at the bottom.
Yeah, don't take that on a flight.
No, no. Now you slowly move, you have 1940s era style 17 Martin guitar, you know, still using forms, a lot of jigs and fixtures, an old fashioned glue pot. And we have sort of the evolution of the case from where CF used to pay farmers to make, they call them coffin cases.
Yeah.
He used to pay the local farmers to make those for him into the newer style plywood cases we have made for us today.
Is this an original then?
Yeah, that's an 1830s. Bending presses, so basically you bent guitar sides over a hot press and then you would check them up against that pattern in order to make sure that it was the correct size. And you see some plywood. We're coming into the 50s. So if you notice on the bottom, it's scallop versus non-scallop bracing. With the war, a lot of the skilled craftsmen went away.
Sure.
So unfortunately, they took their skills with them. So we sort of went away from doing scallop bracing for a while.
That's a very good point, actually. When there have been so many people at war, I mean, was the demand the same for guitars anyway during that period?
The demand was pretty much stayed the same, but we had to do things. We got rid of some of the more intricate procedures. We stopped doing pearl inlay. We stopped doing what's the feature around the top of the guitar called herringbone, and we stopped scalloping braces.
And those guitars at that period, I mean, I take it they're still pretty sought after, even though it would be more simple in terms of
older. Anything up until about a 1970 Martin guitar is considered collectible.
Sure.
And here's a sample of the variety of bending presses we've used over the years. The original ones just had a torch running through here.
Wow, okay.
45 style headstock inlays. It's called the flower pot. And it came from the mandolin craze.
Okay.
Into the 60s and 70s, we're checking scale length, making sure that the nut and saddle are in the correct location.
I mean, it sounds a little silly, but it is crazy to go from when we're looking at the factory as it is now and all the state-of-the-art technology, and then when you have a look here, you know, it doesn't look a million miles away from your arts and crafts at school.
No,
you know,
no, it does not.
Woodwork, you know, and yeah. Yet you're making some of the finest instruments that we've ever seen.
Yeah. The gentleman whose bench was right here, he kept record of various serial numbers he worked on. Occasionally, from time to time, you'll see a note about a weather report, like if it snowed or if it rained. And then he also kept notes on when he got raises.
So if it snowed or rained, what, in relation to the guitar building, like, or was that just what he wanted to just keep a record of?
He was just one of those people who liked knowing, you know, write down when it snowed, because most of the employees at that point were local, and if it was a foot of snow, if CF lived there, so if he could make it to work, you have to make it to work.
Oh, wow, okay. So, yeah. See, when you said that before, I was thinking, oh, that was because of some sort of temperature issue or something like that with the product.
We don't know.
This is the mystery of the day.
Yeah.
Who was this man?
Who was this man? Why was he obsessed with the weather?
Yeah.
We've got a couple of our older spray guns, our original tensile strength testing machine from when we started strings in the 70s. An old mandolin, This was a signature series. It was introducing of a new model. So basically what we did was we had all the department heads, as the guitar would go through production, we would have them sign the inside of the guitar. To show people this is where people sign guitars, we actually built a like pseudo half a guitar body and let the manager sign it. So people would say, look, this is what your guitar looks like on the inside.
Okay, Mike, so we've taken a step upstairs, and what's going on in this very dark room?
This is lovingly called the North Street Attic, and we've come up here for one reason. This was the wood room at one point, where we temperature and humidity control everything. There was a time where we would build the guitar tops, and then they would set them in one of these slots, and then a month would go by, and they'd move it in this slot. Then a month would go by, and then move it in this slot, and go down and down through approximately 3 years,
right,
till it got to that end of the building, and then it was ready to use.
Okay.
So it went through all the heat and all the cold over 3 years to acclimate the guitar backs and sides and tops until we were ready to use them.
That's incredible to think that it would take all that time, because you'd be thinking, I hope we're in business.
Yeah. But if your wood was too wet, it would crack. If the wood's too dry, it cracks. So if you let it breathe with the natural environment, it tends to acclimate much quicker than it would.
And you can feel, I mean, it's particularly cold. So I guess that's the thing. It would get, as you said, it would get as cold as this, and it would be really hot in the summer.
In January, February, it'd be in the negatives, and in 100 plus degrees up here in the summertime.
Yeah.
You know, just to get the wood to be used to moving through various temperature changes.
Very cool. Our tour of the Martin factory continues, and we're in a very special point of the Martin factory. We're here with Mike. What is this building, or this room? What is this?
Well, this is the Martin Archives room. This is where we keep all the old letters and documents and everything we've collected since the mid-1700s.
Okay. You
know, family heirlooms of guitars, any newspaper article that's been printed about us, we keep.
So this is definitely not part of the normal tour, is it?
No, you have to be a very special guest.
Oh, well, fantastic. I feel very honored. So, is there anything that you're allowed to show us in here?
Oh, sure.
Yeah.
Here we have an official journal dating back from the 1830s, and it's in German and English, and it just says, bought of Mr. Kirch a 30-inch silk umbrella, 128 guitar, and the prices we sold them for, and submitted another Charles from Boston, and some of the different things we've sold to him, bundles of strings. And it just goes on, and so this is our ledger from store ledger 1834 to 1837.
So is that the very first one?
Yes, this is from when he first arrived and set up his music store.
Wow. We're obviously associating these days with Martin guitars. You know, you've got your fantastic acoustic guitars, you've got your ukuleles, but there was actually a musical instrument store.
Yes, he sold band instruments, tubas, he sold violins, he sold, there's some clarinet references, and then reeds and accessories and tuners for all sorts of musical instruments. Yeah, it was a full-service music store with a full-service repair center in the back, so if you were playing your tuba and you broke it, you could bring it to Martin, and he had somebody on staff who could fix it for you.
Yeah, and of course, when we get into the museum, we'll get to have a look at what an acoustic guitar would have looked like from that period, but just to give us a kind of brief overview, I mean, how different would have an acoustic guitar from Martin been, or looked like then in 1934, as opposed to something coming out the factory today?
Oh, it's a lot different. They were smaller, a lot more lighter and delicate. One of the reasons we had to beef stuff up is things came in from stagecoach, and you know, the stagecoach bumpity could break and crack guitars.
Okay.
So yeah, the body shapes changed over time. They've gotten deeper and bigger as time went on.
Yeah. And of course you've got here, all the way down here, we have all the archives, as you mentioned, and I mean, you're running out of space here. Where's it all going to go next?
That's a very good question. We are looking to build a bigger warehouse and hopefully house some of this. Because we just picked this up at an auction. These are picture cards that if you went to a movie with starring Gene Autry, you could pick one of these up and take it home with you.
Where did you find those?
They were actually on an online auction.
Right. And you find that people actually contact you, you know, actually contact you guys with, hey, I've got this.
Yes, sometimes we'll get phone calls out of the blue where a gentleman will say, you know, my grandfather had this in his attic for 50 years and then I took it and I'm getting ready to retire and move away. So what do you guys like? And there'll be a letter. I had some guy about a month ago call me up. He had a hunk of wood.
Right.
That was just a fall off from a Martin piece, but it was Brazilian rosewood, and it was, you know. So that's downstairs in our acclimating room now, a circa 1930 rosewood log piece.
Start saving your pennies now.
Yes. This, from what I know, I don't read German, but from what I understand, this is a birth certificate.
Mm-hmm.
And then from what I was told, this is a baptismal certificate. And that's an original Gene Autry signature, a letter about getting his guitars. And some copies of banknotes for people who at the time were, most of them were employees, and that was their paychecks. This is were shop foreman's notes. So we can go back and we can check out the serial number, the day it was made, and see if there's anything special. Because in our records, like especially on older Sunburst, we never said it was a Sunburst. We said it was a special.
Right.
So we don't know if special meant, was it a different nut spacing? Was it a different string spacing? Was it a different finish? So these little foreman's notes come up really helpful. Picture. Soon after the camera was invented, CF and his wife were some of the first to go get their pictures taken. And that's the original Martin house that sits right next door. And there was actually steps several times that would go from either the upstairs or the downstairs over into the side door. Johnny Cash, big fan of Martin guitars. So yeah, that was the family home back in Germany.
Okay.
When CF Sr. was starting to get up in age, he decided to incorporate his business with his son and his nephew. And eventually, once Junior became old enough to run the business, he took over sole proprietorship, and CF Hartman left to go build instruments down in Baltimore, Maryland. Okay. It's a very, really old 1880s era price list.
Looks very reasonable.
Yeah. I'd pay $36 for a guitar nowadays. Right, there's... We bought some rosewood logs.
OG CITES?
Yeah, there was no CITES back in that day. Good or bad. And there's a course, you'll see in the museum, the contour ukulele, where he took it for Admiral Broad's expedition and had a bunch of celebrities and famous people sign it. Movie stills, lots of Grand Ole Opry. We're probably the number one instrument played at the Grand Ole Opry. I don't know if there's anybody who shows up there who doesn't play a Martin guitar.
Certainly that period there, that was a very important time, and especially the D45 on the map.
Mm-hmm. Definitely. Wow. April 1912. And the old barn there was eventually torn down and turned into the powerhouse.
Oh, okay.
When we first started our steam generating.
So how many guitars would have come out of the factory per week then?
Per week? You'd be lucky if you got three a week per then.
Wow.
Yeah. That's late 1950s, 60s, note card, original 1830s headstock pattern. That's what, so the town of Nazareth was a Moravian town, and you weren't allowed to live in the town of Nazareth unless you were a Moravian. Mm-hmm. So this was when CF joined the Moravian Church.
Was that how the town was founded then, with these guys?
No, the company was technically officially founded in 1833. Mm-hmm. And that's an early payroll book. We see a lot of the same names, Vital, Hartman, Keller, Heller's, Connects. And you notice that like, there's several generations, and that was from 1880.
So there you have it, guys, our exclusive behind-the-scenes look at the legendary Martin Guitar Factory. I hope you enjoyed that, and if you did, be sure and check out our tour of the Martin Museum, which features some incredible guitars played by Kurt Cobain, Johnny Cash, and many more priceless instruments that you won't want to miss, so check it out.